On today's episode of Junkin with Jenny, we show you how to create your own barn door style rolling window shutters. Also, creative ideas for an old seat. Plus, how to give a vanilla bathroom a little bit of flavor. Also, ideas on how to fix up an old toolbox. And how to take this salmon out of the kitchen. Plus, teaching an old milk jug some new tricks. Also on the show, what to do with an old trunk. All of that and more on today's episode of Junkin with Jenny. Tony and Jenny Bruschi joining you once again.
Hello.
And how are you this fine day?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. It's always, like I said, it's an exercise in trying to get the intro. Because I'm pressing 30 buttons at once. But it works.
And talking.
And talking, yes, at the same time.
Yeah. So,
and having a glass of wine while doing all of that, which I'm sure makes it that much easier at the same time. So,
yeah. Oh, I think it makes everything easier for me.
It does at a certain point until you have to be technical with things. So, welcome to today's episode of Junkin' with Jenny. It's the show, of course, that we talk about taking older items or spaces and items you don't know what to do with and giving them some new life. I want to help you do just that with the items and spaces that you have. If you'd like advice on any item or space, you can submit it to the show. We can talk about it. Go to junkinwithjenny.com and submit it and give us a little bit of info. We may feature it on a future episode of the program.
Always fun.
That's what we do.
Yeah.
It's always enjoyable to do that. So if you got anything, just feel free to submit it or submit it through our Facebook page as well. And we can take it that way as well. And we may use it here on a future episode of the program. So how are you doing this fine day?
I'm okay. How are you?
I'm doing well. I know you had some issues with wallpaper earlier in the day.
I made a discovery.
And you sent me a text saying day drinking while doing wallpaper or something of that nature. I don't
know. Wallpaper causes day drinking.
Oh, wallpaper causes day drinking. Okay.
I discovered that. Yeah.
And would you like to elaborate on that at all? You don't have to name the store that it came from, but you can talk about the type of wallpaper that it is.
Okay. Well, it's the removable wallpaper that we have featured.
We've
on
talked
this
about this
show before.
Yeah.
And I had really good luck with the first project.
Yeah.
But the first project was just the back of a bookcase.
It was one.
And it's one strip.
Yes.
On each back of the bookcase. It did not have to have a pattern match. So okay. I thought, oh, this is fun. This is good.
Mm-hmm.
Totally screwed me over today on the pattern match. Because the pattern match does not match. And if you have OCD the way I have OCD, it's going to drive me nuts. I could not. It wasn't just a matter of, oh, it didn't go up right. It's I got it perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And then about halfway down, it's like an eighth of an inch off. Looking at the wall altogether, you don't notice it, but I notice it.
Oh, I notice it. I look at it and I go, holy crap, you really bungled this room up. This is a total fail. I'm never going to go in here ever again. I'm going to just scorn this room for the rest of my life. I'm kidding.
I know you're kidding, but it just drives me nuts.
Yeah, I know.
I kept trying and trying, and at least it's the kind that you can pull off and put back on.
In theory.
Freshly painted wall, not so much.
We just talked about that on the show a couple weeks ago. I said, so, like, because it's advertised as you can pull this off.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, in 10 years, can you pull it off? Apparently not in 10 minutes you can pull it off.
Well, the thing is that you had to put this onto a painted surface.
Okay.
Or some sort of sealed drywall.
Yeah.
And this was new drywall. I painted it. I waited till it was dry. And then I put this up. And it screwed me over. I was so mad.
That asshole wallpaper.
And the worst part is I had bought what I thought was enough. Now I've got to go get another roll of this crap and stick it up.
Is it
to
more
finish.
Is it more so made though for like your initial application where it's just kind of an accent piece like behind a bookcase or a weird corner or something like that? Or is this product really designed to be put across an entire wall?
I think it's made to do as an accent wall, if not an entire room.
Okay.
Because the width of it and everything is the same width as regular wallpaper.
Mm-hmm.
But it just, I could not get that pattern to line up.
And this is the sticky back wallpaper. Mm-hmm. This is not where you have to dip it in the stuff and all that. This is, we talked about, like, this is an amazing invention. And it's kind of screwed you over.
Well, and I am not saying that all removable wallpaper is like this.
Sure.
But this particular one, I'm not happy with now.
Is this first round of this product as far as being on the market?
I don't know.
Okay.
I'm thinking it's fairly early on in its life, but I know that there are some big wallpaper companies that have done wallpaper for, you know, over 100 years that are now starting to introduce this. I have no doubt that they have their pattern match exact dead on.
There's better ones.
There's not a problem.
Okay.
But this being what I had readily available in my neck of the woods, mm-hmm.
You bought it from a big box store.
I did.
With a big red bullseye on it, which normally we love this store.
Yeah, I do.
And their products, but yeah, this one, not such a winner.
I still recommend it for a small project where it's just like behind a bookcase or something like that. But if you're doing a whole accent wall where the pattern match matters, I would not do this again.
I was surprised that it didn't match up. And I looked at it too in detail, like going, no, that's not you. That's not.
No.
This is, the product is like, it's like a printing error or something where it didn't match, and there was no way to make it match correctly. It was odd.
So just saying.
Beware.
Yeah.
Buyer beware. All right. On that note, let's talk about some of their failed projects. I'm kidding. like I said, if you have a project you want us to weigh in on or some ideas, submit it at junkinwithjenny.com. Do press subscribe, whatever platform you're listening to us on, iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, TuneIn, Spotify, whatever it is. It helps us grow the show. Let's talk about our first project here today. We did this one a while ago. We've touched on barn doors before.
Uh-huh.
This is kind of another take on barn doors. And this is what we did to some windows at our previous house. And we actually did attempt to make barn doors. I don't have a picture of that attempt, which you're probably happy with. we did attempt to do that, but we had some bowed wood that didn't work out all that well. So we ended up buying literally doors.
Yeah.
And cutting them to make this look happen. And it really did turn out neat. I was very happy with this. And this is just another way of doing the whole barn door look or shutter type rolling shutter over. This was our basement that we did it on. And you want to talk about the project, the initial inspiration for it and why we did it?
Yeah, the initial inspiration, this was in our basement.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, for those of us that have basements, we understand the difference between walkout, view out, and, you know, no view basement. So this was a view out basement. For people that don't have a basement, it's where you have half windows. Mm-hmm. So the front part of the basement's completely underground, but the back part, because it's kind of on a hill, is a view out. In Kansas, we have horrific storms and large hail. So we have found that we honestly didn't feel that secure in our basement with these large windows. So we wanted something that looked cool, but also could be closed off if one of these storms came up with wind and hail and all that, which happened on a regular basis. So we started thinking about something that was sturdy. Obviously, curtains weren't going to do the trick. Blinds weren't going to do the trick. And then we started seeing barn door type of, you know, doors and window treatments and things like that all over the place. And I thought, why don't we do something like that? And we actually had the wall space next to the windows to pull it off. So that's where we kind of got the inspiration. And we tried initially building our own barn doors.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, the wood was less than perfect. Had we bought the expensive wood, we could have pulled it off and it would have worked just fine.
Mm-hmm.
But, and that's honestly what we should have done instead of going back and buying something else. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just bite the bullet, buy the good wood to begin with.
Sure.
But we went back and we got some solid 6-panel doors. Everybody kind of knows what those look like with the 2 small squares and then the 4 rectangles.
And I should note, if you want to see this and see the images of it, junkinwithjenny.com, you can go there. And in this video, this episode is in video form. If you're listening to the episode on a podcast, we do a video version of this at junkinwithjenny.com so you can see what we're talking about as we do this.
And we cut off the 2 small square part. So we just had the 4 rectangles, and that was the exact width of what we needed for our windows. And we put it on barn door hardware, which you can get anywhere now. You can get it on Amazon. It's a lot more affordable. We actually went to the tractor supply store to get this because the only barn door hardware that was available at the time besides this was like $600 or $700 for a complete kit.
Sure.
When that first started to become a thing. So we did that for both of our windows, and we found it worked really, really well, and it provided that extra level of, you know, security. We had a way that it fastened so they wouldn't blow in if the window, for whatever reason, gave way, which, you know, honestly, in Kansas was a real concern.
Yeah, and you can see it in some of the pictures here. You can see, if you look at towards the middle of the windows, you see a little bracing there. And it's tiny on the pictures, but you can kind of see it. And that's what kept it from blowing in should the window give way.
Yeah.
And then it wouldn't fly in and fly into the house. And it's an interesting thing because we did have to get the hardware at the tractor supply store. And this is the heavy-duty barn. This is designed for a barn door.
It is.
I mean,
it was overkill.
I mean, it's the stuff that you would buy today at the Home Depot or at Lowe's or Menards or whatever. That's designed to hang like a single one-panel door.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that would handle this.
It would have because.
Would it?
Yeah.
Is the track long enough to do it the elongated way that we did this?
You can get longer tracks online.
Okay.
So I'm getting ready for a different project in this house, getting ready to buy an 8-foot long track.
Okay.
And it's definitely a lot cheaper than what we spent
on this
at the tractor supply store. Yeah,
because this was designed for outdoor barn use, literally.
Yes. Now, a regular set will hold the weight of a door. It's just the way it's laid out was different. Mm-hmm. It was on its side instead of long ways.
Sure.
But it was the same way. It was actually less because we cut part of the door off.
That's true. That's true. It was heavy duty. It would have held up to a serious storm, I think.
And we got more comments on that when we put that house on the market than I think anything else was. They loved the barn doors.
Yeah. I mean, that has been the thing for a couple of years now. But I think, you know, you're always ahead of the time as far as what people are doing and what they're, you know, what they're watching and what they're actually doing.
Well, thank you.
And you're always doing ahead of it. And that's one of those things where I think, you know, you hit it and it's like, everybody wants this, but nobody's doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was right there. But it was a really neat, neat piece, as you can see. And very doable. I mean, this was a weekend. This was like a Sunday afternoon project.
Yeah.
It wasn't that crazy to do. In order to get it, because you have to brace this thing into the wall, we did put essentially a 2x4, bigger than 2x4. It was like, what was the beam that
it was more like a 2x8.
A 2x8, and first I got that into the studs.
Yeah.
And then I secured the bar into the 2x8.
We essentially used that as a header.
Yeah, so it was easier than just trying to find the studs for the rolling beam itself.
And it gives you that distance out from the wall that you need for the rollability.
Exactly, that was kind of required.
Yeah.
So it could actually roll correctly. So it was a neat project, and there you go. That's the images of it. If you have any questions about it, you can always reach out to us through the website or through our Facebook page, Junkin with Jenny. Just look that up. Ready for a listener question, an idea that they are in search of? Okay, the image that's going up on screen right now. This is just your old kind of farm dining chair is what I would kind of describe it as. You know, kind of ornate and whatnot. It says, this may not be all that exciting, but I really need some feedback on what I can do with this old chair. My grandmother gifted it to me. It's been sitting in her dining room for God knows how long, and now she's in the mode of giving her possessions to grandchildren and family members. In its current state, I don't really have a place for it, but I'd like to find a way to repurpose it. Any ideas, Jill in Athens, Ohio? And Jenny, what on earth should she do with this chair?
You know, I'm a big fan of taking one-off chairs like that and painting it a funky color and putting it someplace where you would normally put maybe a stool or by a door for somebody to sit down and put shoes on. We have done that, a couple of times.
Sure.
We had one that was orange, and then I painted it blue, and then...
And it fell apart.
It fell apart. We used it so much. You know, it was nice to have that. But I've seen, I think your mom has actually done this, taking old chairs and cutting the bottom out and putting planters in them, and they look really neat.
I've seen that, too. I have seen that. And an idea that I had, and I can't say it's completely my own. I did a little Pinteresting on this. And it's a really neat idea, and you can do this to one of two parts of the chair, or I could see like maybe doing it side by side, however you want to do it. And it would be shaving the very front of the chair off, literally like right at the beginning of where you sit,
uh-huh,
and then right below it, then you have the two bars,
mm-hmm,
and the chair legs, just the front. Just literally take a chain, not do a chainsaw, that'd be probably kind of messy, but just imagine you could just slice it like a piece of cheese.
Okay.
Right at the front of this chair, the image on screen. You can take that and then affix it to the wall. You probably need to put like a header behind it of some sort and get it affixed into that and then get it up on the wall. But then it makes a really kind of a neat towel holder or a blanket holder.
Okay.
You could also do the same with the back of the chair,
mm-hmm,
depending on what the design and how it's all laid out. I see the spindles on this kind of go up and down. Sometimes the spindles go sideways,
uh-huh,
or vertical on it. And that could also allow for the same sort of thing where you can slice the back of it off,
mm-hmm,
and then do the same sort of thing of letting it be almost a wall hanger. A lot of times how people use old ladders.
Sure.
Now, for that same sort of a purpose where maybe the chair's not going to hold up so well anymore to someone sitting on it, but you don't want to get rid of it, and you don't want to just throw it away, but it's, you know, you're risking someone killing themselves sitting on the chair.
Right.
Or just being destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
But still kind of having a place for it in a house.
Yeah.
And that could be a way to do it without, you know, at a certain point you go, well, let's keep the chair, but let's refinish it. And then eventually you're taking all the wood off when you're replacing it. And at the point, it's a brand new chair.
Right.
That just
right.
looks like the old chair.
Right.
This is a way to still use the old chair in its current state. And you can do the whole painting thing, you know, the chalk paint on it, whatever color you want to do. And I would certainly suggest, you know, fixing it up to your own decor colors. But I thought that'd be kind of a neat idea for repurposing it somewhat.
Yeah.
How's that?
I like that a lot.
Yeah.
That'd be kind of neat if you slice the front off, like you said, then you kind of almost have like a little shelf with the mm-hmm. towel holder.
Yeah. I mean, I've seen that too, where the front, like literally you have the towel holder and you can put some stuff up mm-hmm. on top. It could even be used like in a bathroom.
Yeah.
You could put shampoo bottles or whatever, you
How
know,
cute.
You know, it's kind of a neat way to kind of make a little rustic thing. And it's an identifiable object too, mm-hmm. where somebody sees it. They're not going to go, what the hell is this? They're going to go, oh my God, it's an old farm chair.
Yeah.
And they just, it's instantly identifiable. And it's just, it's a neat piece.
That's cool.
A neat, repurposed piece that otherwise, you know, may just end up going into the junk heap because it's just not in a great condition. And it's one of those things where you can, if you find an old chair sometimes, I know we've done that, or we've been like at a flea market or an antique store going, look at this old chair.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, yeah, can you sit in it though?
Right.
And yet you're like, I don't know. And, you know, you're not even daring to do it. But, you know, what are you going to do with this odd old chair that's just been, you know, trying to find a new home? There's an idea to mm-hmm. give it new life. You do have to butcher it up a bit, but it still, it gives it more life than just sitting in an antique store or being in it thrown away.
Yeah.
So there's an idea.
I like that.
So if you have, like I said, an object, a space, a place you want some feedback on, junkinwithjenny.com is the website to submit it to. Next one, this is an actual space. This is a bigger place. It's not just an object. Help, my bathroom is blah. It's not in bad shape by any means. It's just too vanilla. I'd like to give this bathroom some character, but don't have a lot of money to spend. I'm looking to take what may be existing, give it some character, or if I have to change anything out, replace it myself somewhat economically. I love Jenny's style and would love to get some feedback. Rebecca in Fort Wayne, Indiana. And Jenny, change Rebecca's life.
Well, at first when you sent me the picture, I was like, what's wrong with it? Because
sure.
it looks good, except I do see that it kind of lacks character. So first thing I would say, the quickest way to make a change on a room with little amount of money is to paint it.
Okay.
And I would try and find a color that maybe, you know, if this is like a hall bathroom, you can do something really fun in there. If it's more of a master bathroom, you know, go for more of a spa feel or something a little, mm-hmm. you know, I guess a little higher end. I know people love tile showers. I can't stand them because I had one that leaked. So I would leave the shower surround as is. Mm-hmm. And it's one of those tub shower combos, which, yep. you know, most homes have those.
Sure.
I would just tile one row of tile right in front of it going all the way up and then tile above it.
Okay.
And then when you have your shower curtain on the rod, you think it's a tile shower. And then you find out when you open it that it's actually a surround. So you're like, bonus, it's not going to leak. but it has the look of a tile shower when the shower curtains close. Mm-hmm. That is a quick way to really jazz up one of those tub surrounds like that mm-hmm. without a lot of cost. It's not near as expensive as having a full tile shower by any means. Mm-hmm. But if you, you know, you can kind of get fun between the color and, you know, there's all kinds of mosaic tiles which go up really easily. Mm-hmm. And it's not directly being hit by the water. So you don't have to worry as much about the waterproofing or any of that. You know, you need to make sure that it's supported behind by, you know, tile backer and all that. But you don't have to worry so much about using like an epoxy waterproofer or any of that, because this is purely decorative. Mm-hmm. But I would do that and then maybe carry some of that tile just above that pedestal sink. It's a pedestal sink, right?
Yes.
And as a small backsplash.
Okay.
That's what I would do.
I would rip the tile surround out, or not the tile surround, but the surround out of the bathtub
uh-huh.
that is existing there. And it's not a bad piece, but I would do tile from the tub up, because okay. a lot of times when you have leaking issues, it's more so coming from the tub itself or from the floor, not necessarily the walls, unless the walls are just really poorly done.
Okay.
If you could do a little research, if you've never done this before, do some YouTube videoing and figure out exactly what the steps are to do a tile surround correctly. And probably some sort of a like a Hardy Backer type thing, a waterproof type thing.
Yeah.
Look it up.
Yeah.
Look up the correct steps. I do not know them off the top of my head, but I know it's not super complex. Get that up, then get some big fat tiles. Mm-hmm. The smaller tiles are going to be a lot more pricey to do a huge mosaic.
To do a big one, yes.
To do a big one. So go with a bigger piece. I would go with like a wood look or something of that nature. I'd probably darken up the rest of the room as well with a new paint job. I would probably antique the cabinet a little bit, probably a little bit of, you know, the chalk paint and mm-hmm. probably some of the wax. And we're going to actually talk about that later in the show on a project that we just did, but to kind of give it a little more aged look. And I would go for more of a rustic look to the bathroom, but I would go with like a wood surround, not true wood, but tile wood surround that are mm-hmm. big pieces. You could do it fairly economically because it's not a huge space. Mm-hmm. You're talking maybe a couple $100 in material. And if you can figure out a way to do it yourself, rent a wet saw. Most home improvement stores do rent those things out. Or if you have a friend that has one, you could probably get that done for a couple $100.
Yeah.
Realistically. And then that's a big piece of that whole shower. I would keep, you know, unless you really want to invest some money, you of course could do, you know, the glass door, although it is a tub, that'd be kind of odd. I would just stick with the curtain. And really just kind of update the rest of the bathroom with a little paint, a little antiquing of that cabinetry there. And beyond that, maybe change out the mirror, maybe change out the lighting a little bit, maybe to some of the... it depends how bright you want. Depends what your function is in this bathroom. Is this a bathroom that you are using to get ready in, that you need to see yourself in? Or is this more of a guest bathroom and a showcase piece? If it's more of a showcase piece, I would go with kind of an Edison bulb type thing.
Sure.
Maybe a dimmer bathroom. But if you're not using it for your makeup and everything else, mm-hmm. Not a big deal then. Mm-hmm. And that's the direction I would take with this bathroom.
You know, something you can do that... You know, with that wood tile mm-hmm. is get like literally just one sheet of mosaic mm-hmm. and you can do a strip along, you know, about eye level.
You can accent
in that shower and that just kind of breaks it up and adds a little, you know, detail touch to it.
Yeah.
And that, you know, most of those mosaics like that, the glass ones or the shiny mm-hmm. ones, they're, you know, they're going to be anywhere from like $10 to $15 a square foot. Mm-hmm. And one of those would go a long way.
Yeah. If you're talking literally, you know, if you're going to do like a line across, you're talking what, maybe 12, 13 square feet or so?
For?
Just to do a line across?
No. You take the one sheet and you cut it into strips.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
So you have even more narrow. Okay. 2 to 3 inch piece that goes through there. No.
Okay.
I wouldn't suggest that because that would be really expensive. And like when I suggested the mosaic mm-hmm. above the shower surround, mm-hmm. I'm not talking about super like do all glass. I'm thinking, sure. you know, you can do a subway tile mosaic or an arabesque mosaic and those are very economical.
There are lower priced mosaics out there, certainly. Just a matter of what you're looking to do. But you know, there's really neat ways of doing a tile look economically now than there used to be. That looks really cool. That's not just here's bathroom tile.
Yeah.
You know, that we used to kind of all be stuck with. So there's some ideas on that. Thank you for submitting the bathroom to us. Next thing we got here, this is kind of neat. I always love these things. This is a carpenter's toolbox. You can see the image of it if you're watching the video at junkinwithjenny.com. In a recent flea market expedition, I came across this old carpenter box. Not being a carpenter or living in 1907, I was a little perplexed as to what I could do with it. I love it, but it still sits in storage until I have some inspiration. Any ideas? Jason in Butte, Montana.
I would use it to change out with, I would change it out seasonally. I would put different types of greenery or something festive in it seasonally, because we have one and I love it. And I put, you know, in the summer, there's, you know, some of the twine balls that have the moss on them. I put that in there. And then at Christmas time, I put something more Christmassy in it. And fall, I put some fall leaves in it. And I just use it in the middle of the table. I just love it.
And ours doesn't have, I mean, this one here has like a literally like kind of the cover to it, or the higher version. We just have kind of the base.
No, we have both. We have one that's a base, but then we also have a tall one that has the handle.
Yes. Where is that one?
Well, it's got the antler in it that we found. It's on top of the bookshelf right now.
I don't remember that one.
And it's got the metal star. Yeah, it's kind of, it's like this one. It doesn't have a lid that lifts up per se.
Sure.
But it's got the tall part that angles up to the handle.
I didn't even realize that.
It's on top of the bookshelf in the hearth room.
I would have taken a picture of it. Because I was just thinking of the one that the elongated one that has the limes and the lemons in.
Yeah,
the, all
yeah.
The time.
That's just a flat kind of tool tray almost.
Okay, yeah.
But this one, yeah, we have a full-on carpenter's tool carrying thing.
I'm sorry, I would have taken a picture. And
I love it. It's made out of old barn wood, and it's not an actual old one that's been used for that purpose. This was just purely for putting decorative things in it.
Okay, yeah, I mean, it really is a neat piece to do all sorts of things with. And I really don't have many ideas beyond what you would suggest. Mm-hmm. There's no way I think I could ever find it in my heart to rip it apart, nor do I see a purpose of doing of ripping it apart for any reason to do anything else with.
The only other thing I would suggest is kind of like what you did with the chair. Upside down, hang it on the wall. Use it as a towel holder slash shelf.
Okay.
Because that handle kind of angles out towards the middle of the box.
Sure.
So it's away from the wall. So you could do it that way.
I could see... I could totally see that on this specific one that we're looking at. I could also see possibly something where you could do the light bulb thing with it too, where you get some Edison bulbs hanging from it. It could be kind of a neat piece, like on the edge of a wall, depending on what your setup is. Not like in every scenario would that work very well, but something rustic, something fun, keeping it mainly in its current form.
Mm-hmm.
So I like this piece a lot. These are really fun. And when you come by them, if you come by them at a reasonable price, buy them.
Yeah.
Because these things, if somebody doesn't know what they have, I'm sorry, but a lot of times these things can go for $80-$90 or more. Every once in a while, you find somebody that has them for like, oh, look, it's $20. Buy it.
Yeah.
Just buy it. Because they're so neat. They're more and more rare to come by real ones. And there's a lot of uses for them, especially if this is the style that you like to do stuff with. Thank you for that one. Okay, here we go. Another space question. It's the salmon kitchen.
Okay.
Who doesn't like salmon kitchens? When you see pictures like this, you know, the picture of the kitchen, and you saw it. Can you picture it in your mind's eye? What the hell is going through the person's mind when they painted it this color? That's my question. I don't care what era you're in. I don't care any of that. Like, what... Is there ever a time or place for this to have occurred? That's my question.
I don't know. You know, when I see that color, it doesn't really automatically bring to mind, like, the avocado of the 70s or the harvest gold of the 60s or anything like that. You know, I was like, I wonder what time frame that was painted that color.
And that's what I mean. Mm-hmm. I can't place where this made sense. I mean, unless the rest of the room was, you know, harvest yellow and, you know, that backsplash was there and maybe it did go with some other thing at some point. Even then, like, none of it would have been very appealing, but maybe it was an accent to something else. That's the only thing I can think of.
So, do they have a specific style that they like?
Here's the letter says, "Who wants a salmon?" Is how it starts out.
Okay.
That's what I feel every time I walk into my kitchen. This thing needs a makeover. It needs a makeover bad. However, my checking account doesn't support a massive HGTV style makeover. Mm-hmm. I'm looking for ideas on how to give this thing a look that's inviting and not so much like the galley of a ship. Your help is greatly appreciated. Liz in Tampa, Florida.
Okay. Painting cabinets is not fun, but it is cheap and it's something that you can do yourself.
Okay.
First thing I would do is, after having dark cabinets like that for so long, lighten them up. I would go either a white, an off-white, or a very light gray.
Okay.
All of those are going to really dramatically brighten up your kitchen and pretty well go with any countertop that you have or want to change out to in the future.
Because the countertop right now is kind of a black tile. It looks like, it almost looks like floor tile put onto a countertop. It's even grouted like floor tile. And then there's a black and almost goldish backsplash that's there, like in the tiny square tiles. It's almost a very, the window trim is almost kind of dark as well.
I would paint the window trim as well. I would paint it, you know, maybe not the same color as the cabinets. Mm-hmm. I would just go with a simple white on the trim. And I would take out the backsplash.
Okay.
That's not always fun and easy, and you may have to do some sheetrock repair, which sounds scary, but considering you're most likely going to at some point put another backsplash back there, you don't have to worry about getting those seams completely hidden.
Mm-hmm.
Something that makes a really cute, price-efficient backsplash is beadboard. And you can take beadboard that's either, you know, the solid wood kind and stain it or do a whitewash on it just to do a little contrast with the cabinets. Or you could do white beadboard. White beadboard with gray cabinets. It'd be super cute, kind of cottagey and more welcoming.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I would do to start.
Okay. If it were me and I was trying to do this on somewhat of a budget here, obviously painting is going to be your best option. There's no ripping this out and going with, you know, even stock cabinetry that can still get pricey pretty quick. I would do some sort of painting on it. You know, if you're okay with your countertop and your backsplash, I think there's ways to make it work. I would maybe go with some sort of a, you know, brownish tone on the cabinets.
Okay.
I don't want to say gold, but something that will be more in line with the golder tone of the backsplash. I'm just trying to think about ways to make this work with what exists. And it may not be everybody's first choice by any means, but if you're just trying to go, I don't have a ton of money here, but I want to make this not hideous, here's what I would do. So I'd go probably somewhere on that scale of sand color on the cabinets. Change your hardware out. That's cheap and easy to do. So rip those bad handles off of that thing. Find some interesting ones. You can do that economically. And then paint the rest of the room something in line with the cabinetry. Let your countertop, let your backsplash kind of be the accent piece of this, and go in that direction. That would probably be the most economic way of changing this thing up quickly.
Yes.
You know, what you suggested also, an economic way of doing it, more steps.
Of course.
Depending on what you want to do. But there's, you know, sometimes it's more like, ideally, I'd love to do this over here, but I only have so much, you know, knowledge of what I'm confident in doing or money to do with. So what's going to be realistic for this situation. Both are realistic, and that's the fun part, because I think when we first started doing a lot of these things, we were more kind of in the space of what I'm describing. Uh-huh. And after doing so many projects and getting some experience here, we're more now in the comfort space of what you're describing.
Sure.
So it's kind of finding the seesaw area of where you're at.
And she really didn't say...
style.
Yeah, style. I mean, I think if you went darker like you're saying, that's going to give the feel of a more modern
it
space.
It is, yeah.
So if you like that, that's the way to go.
Sure.
I mean, I can't stand dark spaces, so I would mm-hmm. just lighten and brighten as much as I could.
Yeah, and I don't know that anymore. I would say 10 years ago, I would have gone with my dark idea.
Yeah.
Today, if I was given this, I would have probably honestly gone more towards your idea. But I'm just basing it on this and like, what's the cheapest way to change this mm-hmm. and be happy and walk sure. away going, I can live with this, uh-huh. you know, and my friends are not going to go, what the hell happened to your kitchen? So that's where I'm coming from. Just kind of the yin and the yang
yeah.
of all that. So there's some ideas on a kitchen space. That's the fun part about the show. We can do spaces. We can do items. We can do whatever. So
I do have one cautionary thing.
Okay. And now a cautionary tale from Jenny.
Since, you know, da-da. Most likely the cabinets are going to be painted. We don't know, you know, which way she's going to go. Mm-hmm. Take one of the doors into your paint store. No, don't do that.
Cautionary tale.
Seriously. Take one of the cabinet doors off. Take it to your paint store and have them take a look and see if it is oil or latex paint.
Yes.
It's going to make a huge difference. A lot of times, depending on, you know, when this was done, oil paint could have been used because it's for heavy duty, you know, trim, cabinetry, things like that were painted with it. Mm-hmm. If not, if somebody painted it with latex, then you're good to go. But you want to find out before you paint, because if you paint latex over the oil paint without properly priming it, it's going to peel off. Quit. I'm trying to be helpful here, and you're just being an ass.
I'm trying to be dramatic.
Stop.
Because if not, it's not going to work.
Well, we had somebody ask us about that very thing
yeah.
2 days ago.
Sure.
So that's why I bring it up, because you don't want to put all the effort into painting your cabinets only to literally have it peel off.
We did. What was what was that letter?
It was not a letter. It was
a
friend who had painted his trim, which was oil-based paint.
Mm-hmm.
He painted it with latex and it's peeling off, and he wanted to know what to do.
Oh, yes. Yes, I remember that.
And okay. Thankfully, it was only one room. And if yeah. he didn't want to sand it off, replacing the trim would be his easiest bet at that point.
And that's something to really think about. Because I think a lot of times if you're new to doing projects like this, you don't think about those things.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a huge difference. Even with what we're doing right now in the basement here, we're making some rooms. I can't even say redoing rooms. We've
right.
created rooms. And we're putting the texture up on the wall. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about, you know, what do you want to use here with this? Do you want to use the water-based texture, or do you want to do the oil-based texture? Mm-hmm. And there's big differences between the two and how it'll apply to the wall and
yeah.
destroy the scent of your house and all of that.
Right.
So,
and there's a place for oil paint.
There
but
is.
You want to make sure that you're going to have this stick.
You
yeah. don't want to have it literally peel off in a matter of months.
Exactly. Exactly. It is something to think about. I thought the drama kind of helped it, though.
It did not help at all. It annoyed the shit out of me.
Of course it did.
Okay.
Milk jugs. I like milk jugs. That sounds horrible. That sounds
milk,
like I could
these
be...
These are milk cans.
Milk jugs.
No, they're milk
I'm going to zoom in.
Thanks. Appreciate that.
I wouldn't call myself a hoarder. This is a letter. This
okay.
is what it says. But I certainly have a problem with buying things that I think are cool and then never doing anything with them. I'm trying to break this trend as my husband is getting rather upset with me. I've been holding onto these old milk cans for probably 5 years now. He wants me to junk them, but I know there's a great use for them. Any ideas on what to do with the milk cans?
I would make a wreath holder out of it. And the way I would do that is cut a hole in the top for a 4x4 post
okay.
to go into it and come up another 2 or 3 feet beyond where the milk can stops.
Mm-hmm.
and put a hook on it and a some sort of finial on the top. And it's almost like one of those welcome posts that you sometimes see by front doors.
Okay,
and
I see.
You can hang a wreath on it, change it out seasonally, put a sign on it that says welcome or happy, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's cute. It's cute. It's weatherproof because these obviously have been out for a long time. And, you know, you can move it. It's not something that, you know, has to be permanently by your front door. You can put it in a different place if you want.
They're already quite weathered. And I love that about them.
I do, too. Yeah. And I wouldn't paint them. I wouldn't do anything to them other than add this part to it to make it stand up.
I've seen some where it's been like done in black chalk paint and then there's like a saying put on the side. I love this rusty.
I'm over sayings.
Yeah.
And I like rust.
I don't like sayings on things. No. And I think that this is just keep it as is and do something cool with it. I saw a neat idea. If you have these two, I think they can make lovely end tables.
Sure.
If you could put, and I would do probably a glass piece of some sort on top so you can see the thing. Otherwise, it gets kind of hidden by the, it's because like, what's this rusty metal pole holding up this circular piece of wood? I would do a metal piece, but, you know, you probably need like some sort of cotton, or not, like, what am I looking for?
I would get
the fabric.
No, I would get the rubber ones. They have rubber feet that basically, they go on the inside of a cabinet, and when you close your cabinet, it keeps it from slamming.
That's what you put between the glass and the top of the...
Yes, because the rubber will keep it from sliding.
Felt is what I was thinking of.
Felt is what you're thinking of. It's the same type of thing, except it's like a
rubber.
A tackier feel.
Okay. Less sliding then, too.
Yeah, that would keep it more in spot.
Okay, I would go with something... I like your idea.
Okay.
So I'd add that to my idea.
Okay.
I stole it. I just took it from you. I grabbed it, and I'm using it.
I'm going to drink.
Okay, enjoy. And I'm going to go just to your camera right now, just you. There's Jenny drinking over there.
You're going to make me spew all over you at some point.
We have new lighting and everything here, too, so it'll short everything out.
Donut of LED lights pointed at
me. No one can see it, but literally this week, we have brand new lighting here in the studio, and she has literally a donut
of light. It's a pink donut with lights. It looks like I should have a mirror in it and do my makeup, but...
Kind of does. And the camera's in the middle.
It works.
And my light is way up over there.
It's a donut of light.
I thought about getting a donut for myself, but I like mine over there. I think that works well. There you go. Donuts of light. That's what I would do, like an end table thing out of this thing. I mean, a lot of people, you know, they jam, faux flowers and seasonal flowers and stuff. And you could do that, too, if you want to put it, like, by a door or whatever. I just think it's more of a functional, everyday use type thing out of this. Or you could actually use it for milk and threaten your children and go, guess what? If you keep being a little ass, you get to have milk out of the jug. And you just, there's no more yelling at the kids. There's no more scolding the kids. Just look at them and go, the jug. And then... calm.
Yeah. Parenting tips from the dark side. That's great.
What's do you see a problem with?
Yeah.
With that, where it's just like the jug.
Yeah.
Would that be scarring? Would they?
Not only would they probably never drink milk again, they would probably never come see you once they were 18.
You never actually do it, but it's just, and then every time they go into an antique store when they're 30, they're like, oh my god.
Just start saving money for therapy now.
My dad just threatened to make us drink milk out of the jug. But you can make it really fun. It's like, guess what? You get the jug. It's Kool-Aid. And it's like really clean and safe. And there's like a bladder of Kool-Aid in it.
Bladder of Kool-Aid. Yeah. That's not something anybody should ever say. That's gross.
It's a bladder of Sharkleberry Finn.
Bladder of Kool-Aid.
And then there's like a spout that at the end of like a cooler, you know, where it just kind of comes out. Like the big igloo coolers. And at first, you're like thinking, oh my God, I'm after drinking milk out of the jug. It's Sharkleberry Finn, everybody. It's a party. You know, in theory, you actually could make that kind of into a neat kind of a party cooler type thing for a party. And you couldn't obviously pour liquid into this metal container anymore. Mm-hmm. But if you did do some sort of an insert into it. And it probably would have to be a bladder of some sort, because I don't know really how you'd find something that fits perfectly that size. But if you did do, make a bladder out of tarping or something that would be usable to keep the liquid in there, and you could get a spout into it, it could be kind of a fun piece for a party.
Yeah.
Wait, this is not a crazy
idea. It's like a Cousin Eddie kind of idea. It's just weird and gross.
I'm just thinking it would be kind of a neat piece for some sort of a get-together, where it's like, that's the neatest thing to get the punch out of or something.
Nobody's going to want to drink punch
from
that.
They're going to be scared of it. Only the person who made it would be comfortable because they know what it was.
You can't suggest it being used for that. And 5 minutes ago, it's a threat against small children to behave. It's not going to work that way.
Everyone else would think it's like, it's just tainted with rust. And it's like, what's a tetanus punch?
Yeah, tetanus punch.
Exactly.
Jeez.
You can't threaten children with it 5 minutes ago.
I'd rather have a bladder of Kool-Aid. It's just gross.
It's new ideas.
No.
New ideas every week here on the show. This makes it a unique home improvement show.
Yeah.
Because we talk about shit like this. Okay. Next item here. It's an old trunk. I think this is a common item a lot of folks have, whether it's been given to them or their parents have it or whatnot. A letter says, in a recent archaeological dig in my parents' attic, I came across this old trunk that's been sitting there for God knows how long. It was packed with old sheets, which were promptly discarded as they smelled of a bygone era. The trunk, however, is in fairly good condition and I think has a new life ahead of it, if I can find a way to repurpose it. Any thoughts on what this might be good for? Jenny, the ball is in your court.
I love old trunks for coffee tables.
Yeah?
They're the right height. They're just a good size for an average size couch. That's what I would do with it. And, it's functional. If you can get the smell out of there, and that's the problem with old trunks, is sometimes you can't get the smell of, Aunt Edna's attic out of there. But if you can, you can also use it as functional storage.
Sure.
Or toy storage or whatever. If not, just leave the baby closed up and just use it as a coffee table. And, you can paint it or you don't have to.
Mm-hmm.
I like the ones that have the wood on it left alone because the wood's usually really pretty on there.
Febreze the hell out of it.
I don't even know that Febreze is going to do that.
They should make like ultra Febreze for old things.
I think you could stick it to him with a stick up and it would still be a problem. Do you remember that?
Remember?
Those little stick on things, like you stick them in trash cans and stuff. It was stick it to him with stick ups.
No.
You don't remember that? Mister, you're the king of every commercial from our childhood.
Stick it to him with stick ups?
Yeah, we're going to YouTube that later. We'll YouTube it and you'll see.
I think it's in a dream.
I just remember it scared me when I was a kid because it would be like they would show this overpowering odor coming out of the trash can, usually like a fish head or something. And it was really scary to me, this giant fish head coming out of the trash can.
Yeah.
And then they'd fight it off with a stick up.
I have a fleeting memory of it.
Yeah.
I barely.
I was scared of the fish head.
Remember Bonkers?
Nope.
The candy?
Nope.
Like where large pieces of fruit would fall on people in the commercials?
Uh-uh.
It was a lot of on Saturday morning cartoons. They almost looked like little pieces of gum, but they were like chewy, almost taffy-like things. Huh. Stick it to them with stick-ups.
We'll watch a YouTube commercial.
I can't wait. Something like this, an idea that came to mind, and I'm not quite sure how functional it would be. It really kind of depends on the space that you have. I'm thinking almost affixing it to a wall and using it as a shelf or a holder of some sort, maybe almost like a TV holder.
Okay.
Probably can fit a giant TV in there, but it's nice and wide. You can fit a widescreen of some sort. So if you have a smaller room or something, or a man cave, a bar, something where even outdoors where you want the TV protected somewhat, there you can put a sealant on the outside of this case to kind of protect it from the elements a little bit. And use it like that. I'm just thinking it'd be a very unique piece. Like, what is that? Why is there a trunk attached to the wall over here?
Mm-hmm.
But it really wouldn't be that much wider than like a TV case that you would have, sitting out there for a television set. I'm I think it might be kind of a unique way to reuse a trunk, other than just a coffee table idea. I love these as coffee tables.
Other than just your idea, Jenny. Your idea.
I mean, the coffee table thing is. I mean, that's what comes to mind right away. And my parents have one in their basement that I'm going, someday, this will be a coffee table of ours.
Sure.
But I just wanted to try and think of something beyond what I think about a lot.
Can I expand on your TV holder idea?
Yeah, go, yeah.
What if you made it as like a giant floating shelf that's like a console?
Where it's hanging
on the wall.
It's not necessarily open. It's like...
It's closed.
It's closed.
It's on the wall.
And the TV sits on it.
Yeah.
I like that better.
Because then you don't have to affix it open or anything like that. But it, you know, you can store DVDs and stuff in there if you wanted.
Well, if the TV's sitting on it, you can't do that.
If you hang it sideways, you can.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So you put the bottom of the trunk against the wall to where it, you know, the lid would open up.
Yep. I could see a way of doing that.
Yeah.
You made it better. Jenny makes it better. You're like BASF, that company that makes everything better. You ever see that?
What is that?
It's a company that you'll see it like on you see it on VHS tapes. We don't make it, but we make it better.
BASF?
I believe that's what it was. BASF. Let me just do a quick.
I can think of is BNSF, and that's trains, Burlington Northern Santa Fe.
No, maybe
you don't know what you're talking about.
Better products, BASF. Yeah, it is. That's what it was. BASF, we make it better.
Mm.
There was their campaign. They ran it for a long time. And I don't know what the hell they even did, but it's like it's a company that took other companies' products, and I don't know if it was like a consulting firm or something. And it was like kind of just this is why you see our logo on shit that we don't make or what it is. But it was something. It was back in the day of stuff like this in the 90s. It's like, we don't make it, but we make it better. That was the logo. That was a slogan that they ran all the time.
That's great because you could totally take responsibility or take credit for something that you had no hand in.
Yeah.
But you can say I made it better.
That's what they did.
Okay.
They said, I think. Yeah. No. So there you go.
Okay.
Okay. We got a product here to review that we sent in to us.
It's actually two products.
Two products. Yes.
Yes.
And you want to expand upon that and show them on. On screen here?
I did not grab the jar of the paint, but I have the wax.
Okay, same brand.
Same brand.
Though. And we will put a link up to this on the page at junkinwithjenny.com for this episode. It's episode number 10. And you can see for yourself what it is and find a way to purchase it there. This is not a commercial, but they did send it to us to review.
And it's by Heirloom Traditions. Mm-hmm. They make chalk paint. And different types of wax. This is a gel wax.
Okay.
Painted one of our vanities. We have two vanities in our master bathroom. And they were both kind of a dark orangish reddish color. And we're getting ready to change the floor in there. So I wanted to go lighter because the floor is going to go darker. So I took this Heirloom Traditions chalk paint in the color French Vanilla and painted one of our vanities. And then I waxed it with the Heirloom Traditions gel wax in Muddy Pond. And the chalk paint was wonderful. It spread really, really well. Got great coverage out of very little product. I really liked it. I was only, you know, I did two coats because this isn't a bathroom. It's going to be something that we're going to use heavily. But what I went nuts over is this gel wax. I have never used a gel wax before.
Mm-hmm.
And I can tell you that if I can open it, I did the whole vanity and there is still that much left in the jar. Can you see it?
Up higher. There you go. Yep.
Just barely used, not even an eighth of the jar. And anybody that has used the...
Show the front of the jar.
Anybody that has used waxes with chalk paint... Usually your clear wax is kind of your coat that seals your product. And then your dark wax is how you get that antiqued look.
Mm-hmm.
This does both. This took the putting the clear wax on and then the dark wax over it and then buffing that all out together to get that look. This made it just that perfect light glazing that I wanted. Mm-hmm. So not only did I not have to use two products, I used one, and I used like just a ridiculously small amount, and it covered beautifully. I love it. It's the only wax I'm going to use from now on. I'm glad she sent this to me because I think I would have been intimidated. I didn't know what gel wax was, but it's night and day. It's definitely the wax to use to get the antique look. Mm-hmm. And they make different colors, so you don't have to go with just that kind of antique-y, mm-hmm. worn, gritty look. You can do different colors of wax over your paint to get different textures to really show up and highlight.
So lots of ways and applications for it and yes. design options for it,
yes.
as well. So.
And you are able to adjust, you know, you can wipe more on, more off for about 12 hours, and then it sets up in about 12 hours.
Name of the product again?
Heirloom Traditions. This is Muddy Pond Gel Wax.
Okay.
And the color of the chalk paint I used, Heirloom Traditions French Vanilla.
Okay, well, the link up at junkinwithjenny.com.
They have a great palette of colors, a lot of colors that you don't see in some of the other brands, and I would really, really recommend it.
Cool. It looks great.
Yeah.
You show me it to them, like, look what I did to the vanity. I'm like, oh my God.
I crank up my hipster yeah. music and I get to go in and, yeah. yeah, 10 minutes later, I had the whole thing
yeah.
completely done.
You said I took like 10 minutes to do this. I'm like, really?
That's hands-on time.
Sure.
You know, you have to wait between
sure.
coats to dry,
sure.
but hands-on time is oh. just really quick.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Cool.
Very good stuff.
All right. There you go. That wraps up today's episode of Junkin' with Jenny. If you want to see the images, what we're talking about, check out junkinwithjenny.com. If you have an object, a place, a space you want some advice on, feel free to submit it to us at junkinwithjenny.com. We may use it on a future episode of the program. That wraps it up for today.
Okay.
All right. Thanks for watching or listening to another episode here of Junkin with Jenny. Until next time, I'm Tony Bruschi. That's Jenny that way.
Okay.
I have it wrong this way on the screen.
I think they know that that's who's over
that's
here.
That's Jenny over there.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thanks for watching, everybody. Good night.